So, good day. I'm Ocean Bailey. I'm basically the event organizer for Jamaican Developers Community, and I'm also a past student or alumni of Google Summer of Code. On top of that, I was also a mentor in 2018, Google Summer of Code. And just for a recap of the last event that we kept about Google Summer of Code. Google Summer of Code, you can call it an internship slash mentorship program, which is globally recognized, and it tailors towards students participating in open source contribution, where you be aligned with open source organization and mentors from those open source organization to help guide you through the whole software development and contribution to your open source software solution. Apart from that, there are some questions. Okay, why should you participate? And of course, this is something that we kind of touched base on in the previous meeting, but we just wanted to, just in case anyone that's on this call didn't see the previous video, we're going to just briefly go over it, and we're going to show you the link where you can go and watch the previous video with Stephanie Taylor. So one, why should you participate? Okay. As you can see on the screen, definitely you gain real experience, not just by working in an organization, working with teams and so forth, but put it like the fact that you're working with a large code base, multiple individuals, so you get exposed to the dynamics of one, accountability, ensuring that your code works despite of the different changes that's being made to the source code. You get introduced to like Git workflow and quite a lot of fundamental when it come on to the software development life cycle, as well as project management. And of course, all of this goes into you from project management, time management, distributed development, where you and someone else might be working on the same project, working on the same file in that source code, and it gets you into a place where you can, understand the source code, understand the changes, and then compare and see which version of the file should be committed or what should be merged, what should be resolved, and it ensure that the code is clean, a quality assurance is there, as you can see, testing and the old version control. On top of that, students will be exposed to, like, of course, the open source world, exposed to mentors and different individuals from multiple walks of life, and you get to build your network not just in this Western hemisphere but globally, because mentors, contributors to open source is from all walks of life on planet Earth. So definitely it's a great means of building your one portfolio, to building your network, because you never know, you might end up getting a job in Japan, Germany, and so forth, and it's just because someone from the open source community that you work with basically identify you, your skills, and passion for software development. All right, eligibility. As you probably already know, of course, to enter Google Summer of Code mentorship slash internship program, you should be over the age of 18. If there's anyone on the call, below that is definitely, there's other programs that we refer you to that is open for teenagers and so forth. But apart from that, yes, over 18 must be attending a university, well, registered at a university between, of course, December 1, 2020 and May 17, 2021. And of course, once you most of these, a matter of fact, all Caribbean countries are in students from any Caribbean country is already eligible to apply. There's no restriction per se to us, apart from the given age, the registration for the in school. And of course, if you did Google Summer of Code before, you can't do it 3 times. You only can do Google Summer of Code twice. On top of that, in the last session, well, after the last session that was held, someone reached out to us and asked us about what if he's doing university in Jamaica, but he lives in Trinidad. Where should he apply from? How does that work? Put it like this: you still can apply, but what's happening is that when you're applying, you will also need a status letter from your university. So of course, you get a status letter from your universities to show that you're eligible and you're in school, as well as you may provide like a brief info about where you live. You don't There's no real requirement on, saying residential area or where you live. It's mostly about that you're, in school, you're a valid student. So a status letter is needed when you're applying for Google Summer of Code. I think that's something that wasn't touched on in the last session, but going forward, that's something you definitely need to keep in mind. All right, as mentioned before, before I continue, anyone has any question about this quick recap of the previous session and eligibility of Google Summer of applying for Google Summer of Code? Okay, no. All right, moving on. As mentioned, Stephanie Taylor, which is basically the program manager of Google Summer of Code, did a session a couple weeks ago. It's published on YouTube, so if you want a full dive in the introduction, what it's about, and so forth, you can literally watch that video. And this video will also be published on YouTube. As a matter of fact, currently it's live streaming to YouTube. Apart from that, we've gathered up some, we collected a couple of questions and answers based on our last session and published those Q&As on our community forum at community.jamaicans.dev. So if you have any question, especially after this meetup, you can go ahead and just publish it on ask it on a forum. All right, you probably will notice like a lot more events will be keeping up starting this month and onwards, and most of these events are sponsored by OSU, which is actually operated by myself and my team. Apart from that, we actually govern and manage the Jamaican Developers community, which of course holds keep all of these events, training workshop, and so forth. And for this event, well, the event's in March, we have two main sponsors, Particle Presence Technology and Vertis Technology. Both are basically local tech shop in Jamaica. One, of course, Particle Presence is a .NET local dev shop, while Vertex is more geared towards like React, PHP, and QA, code security, code infrastructure, and mobile development. So these two sponsors are one of the reasons why we're able to keep more and more events. And of course, we definitely thank them for all of their contribution. Right, so program timer. In January, of course, organization it was applying for Google Summer of Code. We're now in the period between March 9th and 29th, which is geared towards, after the announcement, students getting familiar with these organizations that were announced. And the next step after 20, March 29th is geared towards, students submitting their final proposal. So during this period, what if you haven't started, you probably need to one, find an organization that you're interested in, two, find a project that you're interested in, and then start to look at, their tech stack, start to look at their culture, and start to prepare for, your proposal. So one, you can have it ready when it's like GSOC student submission is open, or have a draft where, the open source community can look at. And of course, I'll touch on those later with some tips and techniques that you can use to find good projects, as well as how to position yourself for the application period when it's open. Apart from that, after April 13th, of course, the May 17th is the next big milestone where accepted students will be announced. And between May 17 and June 7, that's community bonding period with the organization. You get to know their culture more, you get to meet the mentors, you get to meet, get introduced to their tech stack, coding style, and all of the things that you need to know to, be a very informed and very versed in their tech stack for you to contribute to their open source technology. After that, June 7 to April August 23 is the coding session, and last and least, which is not least, is August 31st. Where the announcement will be made about all of the students that are successfully completed Google Summer of Code. There's some things to note about basically the evaluation of Google Summer of Code, but since we covered most of the evaluation periods and times for Google Summer of Code in our previous video, I recommend that you watch that either at the end of like another time or at the end of this meeting or so forth. Before I continue, are there any questions for anyone that didn't get this information? Nope. All right, so what should you do for, preparing for the student application period when it's open, March 29th to April 13th. Of course, as mentioned before, you need to find an organized open source organization or project that you're familiar with or maybe interested in. After that, you introduce yourself to the community for that organization or open source solution. You get familiar with the tech stack guideline and so forth. You start contributing by just fixing minor issues. And trust me, fixing minor issue can literally take you far away, because there are some minor issues, like for example, a CSS a code for a particular color that needs, there's an issue for it that's been out for 1-2 years, but no one actually went ahead and fixed it. So those type of scenarios can really help you to, you know, contribution to help you get started and get noticed, because you're actively, you know, thinking about the open source, contributing and so forth. And as well, you start drafting your application, and I'll touch base on some sample examples and we can get some guidance for drafting your application. One thing to note, the Palisades Foundation, which is run by Peter Allison, he got through with putting one of Palisades' project on Google Summer of Code project list. It's called Tarawa. It's a mobile app as well as web, which geared towards like a modular way of managing groups' activities for both NGO and businesses. Of course, the first build is geared towards churches and managing the activities for churches, but that's one of the main success of like all of this initiative. So the Palisades Foundation tend to work with Jamaican students through the Calcul Challenge. This year, of course, Calcul is not keeping, but the project is continuing under Google Summer of Code. He's pretty much open and available to most, all of the Jamaican students. There's a Slack channel that you can join. Communicate with the individuals that were on the Calcul project slash Tarawa from like I think 2018 to 2020, which is quite a lot of Jamaican students. So the mentors for the Tarawa project tend to be Jamaican students, past students of Google Summer of Code, and there's an additional international mentor. So this is one project I definitely recommend that you can look at and participate in contributing to the Tarawa project. All right, about finding an open source organization or project. All right, so first thing is to, of course, go to Google Summer of Code. You can search for an organization based on like their name, interests, like skill set that you already have, for example, Python, Flutter, and so forth. Afterwards, visit the organization project idea page, the community forum and chat, GitHub repository, and you start to check like if they have, you know, good support from their community, like the community is very active, they have proper documentation and the code is pretty clean and quality and easy to understand. Because you want to be in a position where you tend to, of course, you get that support that you need from the community, as well as get the support you need from the documentation. And it's pretty much, the code is pretty much easy for you to navigate, understand, and, you know, contribute. So I'll take you through the process that I tend to use when I'm applying for any of these mentorship or internship programs. Hold on. So firstly, of course, go on the GSOC site. Once you go on it, you, of course, click on organizations. I'm a full stack Python developer by default. So at times I'll just search for Python. So when I search for Python, of course, a list of organization will come up. Python tends to have quite a lot. The Python Software Foundation tend to have a lot of projects under their belt, because they're pretty much a programming language, you know. So there are times when they take on sub organization that didn't get through Google Stream of Code directly, and they end up just asking Python if they could, you know, put this on their project idea. So Python Software Foundation is a great place to look if you're interested in Python projects. And they give like a detail of what they tend to ask for, what they tend to look for, and some recommendation for you to, you know, do. With Google Summer of Code, of course, when you go on an organization, they give you a link to basically the organization GSUP page. They also will give you the link to like the community chat, mailing list, and someone that you can email to contact and ask questions. And it's very important for you to ask questions and just communicate with the GSOC. Okay, there's no question. GSOC organizations. All right, so I'm going back to so I already found proper organizations that I tend to like their structures. So for example, there is this organization, which is the Chromium Foundation. Chromium tends to be well-supported, and on their organization, they fall under Python. So if, of course, you can search for Chromium or search for Python, use simple scroll, and there's a bunch of different organizations that you can find. So if you're in game development, mobile development, Flutter, PHP, whatever, you can just, there's even LibreOffice there. You can just search for organizations based on your interests. And of course, if you want to become a database admin, there's PostgreSQL and MariaDB that you can contribute to. And they, of course, each organization will give you a list of things to do, things that you need to know, and so forth. But I'll go back to Chromium because, like I said, it's well-structured. They give you some best practices and where you should probably reach out to. They also give you like a roadmap for like the couple projects that they have. And you notice, for example, this project, roadmap for chromestats.com, they state the project, what it is and so forth, the desired skills that the student must have, the difficulty level, and you can click here to see the project proposal. But this is one thing that I do like about Chromium, is that they actually give you a link to like to look at some existing, you know, starter bugs that you can try and fix. So you get used to their, hold on. Okay, you can get used to their code base by just looking at like the problem. And sometimes it's very detailed enough where it will tell you where to look in the source code, what to adjust, and so forth. And all of this will basically help you to get used to, you know, their tech. And like just upon, you know, applying, hold on, want to admit someone. Just upon applying, you can mention that you already contributed. You can mention that you got used to like these type of the text that they're using, and you can literally post a reference to the changes that you made and so forth. Another place that I tend to look on the Python GSOC website is the project idea. And they have quite a lot of project ideas listed here, each of course with the links to the repository, links to the different documentation that you might be interested and need to know, as well as code, the code styles, coding guidelines, and anything that's hold on. Okay, sorry about that. A video was passing. So apart from that, as mentioned, if you look for Flutter, you definitely see Palisaders. And if you want to contribute to the Palisaders, you can go there, contribute to Doc, not Docker. Sorry about that. I'm actually the Docker community leader for Jamaica, so I tend to say Docker quite a lot nowadays. So Dart, which is the language that is used to build Flutter applications, you can also look at their list of projects, go to their community forum, and also contribute to Dart. So when you're selecting open source of organization and project, I do recommend that one, you find something that you're interested in. Of course, if you're doing Flutter development, look for a project to do in Flutter. If you're interested in web technology, probably like PHP, Python, or so forth, basically gear towards those type of project, because what happened is that you most likely will be willing to do the project because you find the language, the framework, the infrastructure, or whatever very interesting. And because of that, you most likely strive to complete the project and contribute quality code value to the project instead of just patch, do something and that's it. And of course, as mentioned before, get familiar with the guidelines and documentation and tech stack. Visit the repository. Look at the existing issues and at least fix two issues. And I mentioned right, that will give you some leverage when you're applying because these started to see, they see that you started to, contribute, you started to learn their technology, and that will really give them the impression that you're interested. And of course, the amount of things that you might be doing when it comes to contribution, and of course your background, it's really will help you to, get through the application period. Of course, will be selected, but it's not necessarily a 100% yes you get through, but it's definitely a start. But before I continue on this part, is there anyone in on the call that isn't sure about any project that they would like to do or don't haven't selected an organization or don't know where to look or where to go at this point? All right. Unsure. Quite a okay. So I'll start with Rashid. If I pronounce that properly. Okay. If you can you unmute and from your perspective, tell me a bit about you, like when come on to tech stack and background. Let's just walk through a quick process of finding something that you might be interested in.
All right. Good afternoon again. Are you hearing me clearly?
Yes.
All right. So for me, I'm still in year one. I'm
Oh.
getting a hang of Java. I have some I have a good understanding of HTML, CSS, JavaScript, front-end development. venturing into backend side as well with Node.js, not so strong on that one. But that's where I am now as it regards skill set. I've been looking at some of the organizations on GSOC to see where I could align my skills. But I'm unsure as regards the whole matter of pitching a proposal to an organization. I'm not just some sure on that piece there. How do I go about
Okay.
pitching a project?
Okay. So I'm actually going to touch on that because I'm going to actually use my proposal and two other proposals that I reviewed to show you what the structure tend to look like and some of the elements that you should put in your proposal. So first, if you're in the first year, what's your Even though you're in first year, are you familiar with basically like Git, the open source and industry and so forth?
Not so strong as you guys, the open source community. I have a knowledge of it, but I wouldn't say I am adept with open source projects.
Okay. All right, so what I would recommend, of course, you're just getting into web technology, and that's something, of course, you can take a look at. If you're comfortable with Java, of course, I would definitely recommend that one. Okay, you start with the tech stack, which is basically Java or Node.js. Honestly, I would say Node.js is probably an easy route for you to take when it comes to finding a project and doing it and completing it, not to mention software testing, development, and so forth. But after you find, of course, a tech stack that you can do for one of these projects, think about what you're interested in. Like, for example, I'm very interested in game development, but for some unknown reason, the last 10 years of my life has been all about web and AI because those are other interests. So I tend to do projects, open source projects around those. But of course, what are the industries that you're interested in? Are you interested in like health, finance, and so forth? Find like a project or a co organization that deals with those. Mainly because one, if you're interested in the industry, you're interested in tech stack, you already will be willing to go out and think about like, okay, for a medical doctor, what would they normally do? Like, for example, there's this open source organization called Libra Health, which is geared towards our open source hospital management system. And from your perspective, oh, this is something that you might be interested in. In Jamaica, there might not be like a bed management system. There might not be something for vaccination and so forth. How can you contribute that? Or if look at if Or basically look at the list of projects that they have and basically work on one of the projects that they suggest. I'll touch base on the proposal later on, as mentioned, but before I continue, anyone else has any question or comment about the organizations and project?
Oh, thank you, by the way.
Okay, no. No problem. Okay, that's enough. All right. To continue on this, so once you get introduced to the community, you start to fix one and two issues. you update the change log, because most of these open source organizations require you to actually state what you change and probably write a unit test or integration test to just ensure that what you wrote didn't broke anything. So that's another thing that you'll be introduced to, and it's really going to help you later on to become a quality software developer and ensure that, you know, Chewy don't put back your code and say something is wrong with your code and there's a back and forth. You get the feel of how to test your own code, look out for some of these hiccups that you probably didn't account for while you were implementing something. And of course, with any open source, you know, you create a pull request. And for pull requests, GitHub and Git, we're going to actually keep a separate session about that to get you guys, you know, ones who don't familiar with GitHub and Git workflow. We actually did a video about it last year, but we're going to do it again, especially in this type of environment. And of course, a pull request is basically just something that someone has to approve the changes that you made, which is compared to the previous changes that someone else had made or before you made the changes. And what after that, I'll definitely recommend, once you create that pull request, post it in the community forum for that organization to tell them, oh, you've done this, and you want someone to review your code, review the pull request. And all of this will help with the community building, bonding, and people getting to know about you and that you already started to contribute to their open source. All right, so this is where I'm going to get at, Rasheen, when it comes on to the proposal. So things that you should put in your proposal, of course, your name, contact information, GitHub or Bitbucket profile. I would 100% recommend that you use GitHub. That's basically one the largest open source repository management system on the planet. And it's publicly known by almost everyone in tech. So if you don't have a Git repository, GitHub profile, I recommend you create one and just start to go around and fix one or two bugs to just show that you're contributing and so forth. And it's very easy to create one and really get started in open source. You need to put in your university details, which is basically which university, the graduation year. Well, you mean, I'm not 100% sure if you need to put in when you started, but the graduation year you may need to put as well. I think it's probably mostly only the graduation year, and basically the location of the university. Of course, the proposal is supposed to be sent with your status letter from your university. And of course, I'm not sure where you get that at other university, but I know that for UWE, it's in the, I don't remember that building for some unknown reason, where Bursar is.
You requested from SAN.
Okay, thank you. Can you repeat, Latifa, where you get it from UWE?
You can request it from SAS. Go to the type in BOSS online, go to the BOSS, the Bursar online student system, it's online, and you get it within 3 to 10 days, depending on the time period that you.
Okay. And please, you may need to let them know that it's referring to Google Summer of Code or a mentorship program. Hold on. Okay. All right. Apart from that, you write a bit of about you, a bit like background, like technical background, and a bit of, you know, past experience in the field. So for example, Rashid, I'm going to use you as an example. You have experience with Java, or say you have experience with Java or Node.js for X amount of time, years, and this is what you develop or done within that. You basically can state some of that as well. Then you put like an abstract about the project. In a certain sense, the abstract should not 100% be exactly like what the organization have on the project idea. You should probably put one and two of your own concept or understanding of the project, as well as the project proposal and goals for the project. Of course, project proposal and goals is geared towards, okay, this is a project, this is the problem, this is what you want to do, and this is what you want to accomplish. And based on that, now you get into the project timelines and deliverables, where you state, okay, since Google Summer of Code is coding period is between this time to that time, June 7th to April. Okay, sorry about that. I probably have to look back at this for a quick second. All right, yeah, June 7th to August 23rd. You basically break down the timeline into different deliverables to state that this is what you want to achieve within 2 weeks' time, three weeks' time, and so forth. And you're going to see an example of that in the proposal that I have for myself. Apart from that, there, you know, any contribution history whereby you contributed to open source. It's not necessarily mandatory. If you haven't contributed to open source, that's fine. If you have, that's great. But these are some of the things that they tend to look for in a proposal. And like I said, I'll show you an example. Some proposal tips that I would recommend, include projects that you've includes projects that showcase your contribution related to the tech stack. So for example, if you've done a Flutter project, even if it's like a calculator, yeah, mention it. Because it shows you already started to get familiar with the, you know, code base. You already started to do one or two things. It's better you show that you have some experience than no experience. It will help boost confidence. So in a certain sense, yes, you do need to market yourself a bit. Because of course, if any of you in any a position of an organization, yes, you want people to contribute, you want to help students to learn, develop, and earn. But at the same time, you want to ensure that, you know, the students that you're picking at least can do the project. They don't necessarily want the best of the best, the creme of the creme, but individuals that are willing, interested in contributing to their open source projects. So another thing that I would recommend is basically put in the about section, mention why you're interested in the project. The project that I did in 2017 for Google Summer of Code, why I was interested in it. It was a Plone project, PLONE, which is basically a Python web application. One, I was interested in it because literally that's the framework that I use at work. Two, I'm a Python full stack developer. So it got me introduced to no SQL database, meaning you don't have to write SQL statements. It introduced me to a lot of front-end development, introduced me to a lot of DevOps, a lot of software testing. It's literally like an encompass, like Kuhn could be described of one of those simplest, easiest operating system, even though it's actually a framework or a CMS. So it's pretty interesting. And I was fascinated about how well it was built and so forth. So I put all of those in my proposal. Of course, don't write a paragraph, probably a 1 or 2 sentence why you're interested in the project. Start contribute to their code base by fixing bugs, which I stressed on earlier. Mention mentors or community members you've spoken to, so they know that you're already aware of individuals that, you know, worked on the project, so you can easily go for guidance or go and get some guidance, or you already started to talk to them to get familiar more with the tech stack. It's literally you're setting up yourself in the sense that you're saying that you're engaging the open source organization and all is starting to contribute, even if it's just a conversation and getting ideas. And based on that, now you can then propose any possible mentors that you want for your project. Of course, if they're available. So that's what I did with my proposal. I mentioned 2 individuals. One was literally David Bain, which was actually my lecturer at UWA, as well as he was my employer at the time. So I had close connection to him. And then the other mentor that I recommended or asked for is Asko Soka, which is, he lives in Europe, but he's said to be one of the smartest guy in that particular organization. So, and the stuff that I saw him develop, could you type the name? Okay, David Bain and Asko. I think it's Soka, something like that. Please note the Prune Foundation for this year wasn't selected for Google Summer of Code. I'm not sure why. But they are not proposing any projects, not even on the Python Foundation. But I'm not 100% sure if they're going to submit a project on the Python Foundation. So that's something that I would have to confirm and then get back to everyone on that. And lastly, use Google Docs. Your mentors will literally help you to write your proposal. They won't write it for you, you know, right on the documentation, but they'll comment on it and tell you what you probably need to add, what you need to change, what you need to remove. Of course, they are the ones who selected you, and they are the ones want you to get through the application period. So, you know, you could be selected and continue to work on the project. All right, so I'm going to show you a sample, but generally these are some links that you can go to the program site to see like some guidelines, as well as the student guide is posted on GSOC website. I'm going to show you my proposal. that I looked up. Okay, so it's not well formatted right in this font. I kind of went a bit extra. You don't have to be this detailed, but I had a lot of background in Python. So and then the Prune Foundation literally gave me a script to follow. For example, put my personal information right here. Ask about the university where I'm studying from, which is the school, and the link to the school website. Graduation date, which was 2007. What's my major, and which computer science. After that, I basically, it asked me like, okay, what am I interested in from a programming language side, and stuff, some of the stuff that I've worked on. For me, let me zoom in a bit. So for me, like I said, I kind of went too overboard with my okay, so one, I worked on a personal project called VoSign, which was a voice to sign language, voice to video. So you voice it and then you see someone literally doing the sign language. I also worked on some, contributed to some open source projects like Coty PDF, Coty Alert, Coty Google Analytics. So I put one, the projects that are related to Python to show that, oh, I have Python background. Even the VoSign was written in Python. I also put projects that were related to front-end development, because the project that I was working on was a WYSIWYG editor, which is basically a team editor. So it required a lot of JavaScript knowledge, JavaScript, CSS, and so forth. Didn't require a lot, but you know, like a beginner amount. So I literally showed some of the projects that I worked on. Like I said, if you don't have a lot of projects under your belt, you still can, you know, get in. It's all a matter of you just showing that you're interested, you can do work, and you started to show some contribution to their open source project. So after that, you know, as mentioned before, they will ask, have you ever worked with this software before? If you say no, that's fine. But it's really good if you have some base knowledge of the tech stack that our organization is using. And it's after that, now it goes into the proposal. Oh, for me, here's a question. Have you spoken to anyone in the Prune community about your project? And I indicated, yes, I spelled his name correctly. Oh, I indicated three individuals, actually. David, Chris, and Chris is basically the individual that created the Prune team editor. I feel like I got that wrong. I'm not 100% sure if it was Chris who created that project. I hope whoever did don't see watch this section. And there's Asko, as I said, was one of my other mentors. So I gave an abstract about the project and what I proposed to do. And after that, I gave basically, okay, some of the goals that I'm trying to accomplish. Upgrade the team editor to the latest version of ACE editor, which is basically a lot of websites are using for, you know, that document like editor, for example, Code9 was ACE, and there's some website that are using ACE. Implement, you know, drag and drop for files, implement drag and drop for folders, and so forth. So all of these stuff literally are simple JavaScript and CSS interaction and implementation that I did. So the project wasn't really big, but it got me in, and it got me a lot of experience. So you just state the goals that you want to accomplish, and some of the stuff that you want to do. After that, now you can have additional goals, and additional goals are like nice to have. Like, for example, if you finish all of the main goals, the project is completed, you're successful, and so forth. And additional goals are, okay, if you have the time, I can implement these, which I don't think I did. Maybe some of it I did, I'm not sure. So after that, now you just state the deliverables. Things that you identified, documentation, upgrades, let me scroll down the timeline. So the timeline, you state, okay, when you're going to accomplish this, when will you finish this function? What would you be doing before GSOC, during GSOC, and after you completed like your main goals, what would you be doing? Will you do software testing? Will you do integration, writing documents, and so forth? So you state some of those, and you basically state when you're going to aim to wrap up and when you're going to do your final submission. Like, my proposal is available on the community forum, and I think we're running out of time. Actually, we're all out of time. So I'm going to quickly wrap up and probably 5 to 10 minutes of Q&A. So I recommend, of course, from the tech tips, learn Git. As mentioned before, have a GitHub page, get familiar with software testing in the language or framework. Learn about Scrum technology. Learn about GitHub workflows and feature branches. And there are other tips that I would recommend. Okay, I'm actually running out of breath. Hold on. All right. And get familiar with IDE. I recommend VS Code. And some of the extensions that VS Code have will help you to, you know, develop faster and give you, literally, you don't have to go outside of VS Code to search for every single topic. Some questions that we tend to have, when it comes to the time, it's 10 weeks for good sum of code. It's around 13 hours per week. And when you come on to it, can you participate? As mentioned before, anyone can participate once they, you know, meet the requirement. And after that is some links. Like I said, the program site, the student guide is available. You can also go on the community forum. On our community forum, I'll make, we have the videos for GSOC that we did, already published. we are going to also put this presentation on our forum so you can look over it if you need any guidance. And with that said, if there's any questions, you can ask, and right now, like 5 to 10 minutes of Q&A. Are there any questions?
Yeah, just one question from me, Tobili. Usually I receive the information. Oh, never mind. I just went in the chat and saw it, so never mind.
Okay. All right. Noted. That was Rashid, I think. Are there any other questions?
Yeah, good afternoon.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
So I'm in my second year, right? And it seems like I'm underqualified for this. As I have some experience with web development, a little CSS, and a little HTML, but a little JavaScript, and I'm familiar with Python. And I'm learning Java right now. But these stacks I'm looking at, and so we include JavaScript and MongoDB and Dart. I'm wondering if I can learn on it, if I can learn on the program, or if I'll be a burden or so.
So, generally, software developers learn on the job. So, yes, you will learn on the program. When I did Google Summer of Code, the project that I did, I didn't know anything about their code base. I'm familiar with Python. I did a couple projects for Prune, but what I got thrown into wasn't anything that I was familiar with. So I had to learn on the program. It wasn't hard because this outer work is, for example, you don't know X, you communicate with your member and your mentor, and your mentor will say, oh yeah, that you can look in file A or file B. Is basically what it's doing. I think you should do this. They will help guide you to learn and develop, because any given thing you go on, whether it's software development, project management, and so forth, once you enter a new organization, you won't know everything. You probably wouldn't know anything about the organization and even the tech stack. So the point of the whole mentorship is to help guide you. So it's okay if you don't know everything, just know that there will be help for you to, you know, bring you up to speed so that you can do what you need to do. So don't think about whether you're not qualified or what. Think about, okay, these are the tech stack that they have. You probably have basic knowledge. What should you put on your proposal, and how can you upskill yourself to somewhere you probably feel confident to actually do the project? But generally though, there's a lot of help and guidance for you in the program, and this is why it's a mentorship program. Oh, and the projects will show you whether it's for advanced, intermediate, or it's basic. So for example, this difficulty level medium, medium, where's easy? medium to hard. So there's no easy. Okay, apparently there's no easy. But just I recommend you recommend it. Just if you don't feel like you have the skill, just upskill yourself. You have X amount of time until the application is over, period is over, and then you have X amount of time to the coding period start. And of course, like I said, there's a community, there's YouTube, there's Google for you to upskill.
All right, thank you.
Okay, no problem. Any other questions? Okay. All right. With that said, I hope everything you find was insightful. As mentioned, all of the resources will be provided on our community forum, which is community.jamaicans.dev. If you have any other questions, you think we could assist with, you can reach out to us on the community forum. Otherwise, reach out for Google Summer of Code specific questions. You can also reach out on the Google Summer of Code forum and groups. So with that said, thank you all for attending. I hope it was very insightful, and we'll see you next month around this time. Oh, and the next month, the focus will be towards finish up the application period, as well as a quick deep dive into Git to get you familiar with the basic. So as mentioned, Git and the student application is what we're going to focus in next month's meetup. So again, thank you and see you then. Ciao.